إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it is of the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that every time He sent a prophet, He sent with that prophet miracles, in Arabic ayat or mu'jizat. Every single prophet was given miracles. And the purpose of those miracles was obviously so that the people recognize, they understand that this man has the if you like, blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is sent by Allah. He is the representative of Allah on earth. Literally, he is Rasulullah. And so every prophet brings forth such extra normal, supernatural activities that nobody can doubt when they see this sign. That this is a man that Allah has given him a certain power. That he has the power of Allah. Not he has, but Allah has given him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed him with something that demonstrates that this is not an ordinary human being. This is a Rasul from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And every prophet was given miracles. And we know many of them, and many of them are unknown to us. So the prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was given the miracle. Of the miracles he was given was to be saved from that fire. That the entire city, the entire civilization came forth to look. And a fire was built, the likes of which they had never built before. For days they kept on throwing in firewood. It was going to be an event for all of the city to see. And lo and behold, when this mighty king tried to show his strength, tried to show his tyranny, tried to prove his injustice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enacted a miracle in front of their very eyes where the fire could not harm Prophet Ibrahim. He was thrown in and he literally walked out completely free and unharmed by the fire. This is simply impossible for any human being to do without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also know of Musa and Fir'aun. How many miracles were given? Allah says, "Fi tis'i ayatin ila Fir'aun wa mala'ih." I have given you 9 miracles, and every one of these miracles was something strange, something amazing, that Musa alayhi salam would put his hand into his pocket and it would come out and it would be brighter than the sun, that the staff would become a literal snake, that it rained literally frogs, that the river Nile became blood. All of these they saw with their own eyes. They saw with their own eyes. You cannot deny that which you see. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wastakbaru, they were arrogant and they turned their backs on that. The Prophet Jesus, Isa ibn Maryam, how many miracles was he given? From his very birth, the most righteous and pious lady that history has ever seen. As Allah says in the Quran, that Ya Maryam, when Allah istafaki wa faddalaki wa istafaki ala nisa'il alameen. That O Maryam, alayhi salam, Allah has chosen you above every single woman of the world. Maryam alayhi salam, nobody could doubt her chastity, her honesty, her ibadah. The whole community, all of Jerusalem knew who was Maryam, who this lady was. And then she comes forth with a baby. And her word against her reputation, against what is known by science and experience, that no woman can give birth. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the baby to speak from within the cradle while her mother is while his mother is holding her. And then so many other miracles, breathing the life into the birds. And so many other miracles in front of their eyes. He resurrects the dead by the permission of Allah. In front of their eyes, he heals the leper. He cures the blind. All of this by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? So that when the person sees, nobody can simply call and the person comes out from the grave. Can you imagine if you had seen this sight? That everybody has seen that this man has died. They've buried him. That khalas, he's gone. And then Jesus calls his name by the permission of Allah and he comes out of his grave. How is this possible? What is the purpose of these miracles? To prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that these prophets are prophets sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every prophet was given a miracle that his people would best appreciate. And this is of the wisdom of Allah. The king Nimrud, at the time of Ibrahim, he would consider himself to be the most powerful person, the mightiest person. So he builds the biggest fire, and Allah saves Ibrahim from that fire. The tyranny and might of Nimrud is thrown in his face. Musa and Fir'aun, the society of the Pharaoh of ancient Egypt, the society of ancient Egypt, it excelled in the black arts, in black magic. They could do things that were unimaginable. They could control the jinn, and they could make their staffs wiggle to appear like snakes. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? He gives Musa types of miracles that the people of Egypt could clearly appreciate. They've seen wiggling things before. They've seen a staff that wiggles, and they think this is a snake. But now Musa alayhi salam actually brings forth a live snake from the staff. Go beat that. They have seen things light up in the dark. Little bit of flickering of light here and there. The jinns can do this. Now in bright daylight, Musa alayhi salam brings forth something brighter than the sun. Go beat that. So the genus of miracles is the same genus that every society understands. The genre that the miracles come forth is a genre that society understands. Jesus Christ and his society, the Romans at that time, they considered themselves to be the chief practitioners of medicine. Nobody could cure better than the Romans. The doctors of the Romans were famous around the globe at the time. So Isa ibn Maryam does that of healing that nobody can do. He heals the leper. Leprosy was an incurable disease at the time. Only recently have we cured leprosy by the permission of Allah. He resurrected the dead. Let's see if science can do that. He takes forth a person who was born blind at Akmaha. And he says, kun, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and here is a man that can see. Now science, now doctors, see what you can do. So every society was given miracles that they have the capacity to understand. They have the wherewithal. They have the knowledge to appreciate that that is something that is clearly beyond the power of human beings. So what then was the miracle of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? We all know that his miracle was the Quran. We all know that the ultimate proof that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was given was the Quran. Now I want you to understand, our Prophet ﷺ was given hundreds of miracles. And there are many books written about the miracles of the Prophet ﷺ. Mu'jizatun Nabi, right? Dala'ilun Nubuwa. There is a category of books called Dala'ilun Nubuwa, the proofs of the prophethood. And this is a category of books that many scholars, Al-Bayhaqi and Al-Daylami, they have written books that literally, Al-Bayhaqi's Dala'ilun Nubuwa goes into 12 volumes. 12 volumes! And it is nothing but one miracle after another. And yet, when it comes to the ultimate proof of what was the proof of our Prophet ﷺ being a prophet of Allah, it is clearly the Quran. So the Quran is a far bigger miracle than all of the other miracles that we have heard about. Than the water coming forth from his hand, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Than the tree, once the Prophet ﷺ wanted to use the restroom and there was no tree close by. So he literally took one tree and another and he dragged them together. The roots of the trees moved together so that there is a shrubbery there. In front of everybody, they can see the trees being dragged in the ground. And he communicated with animals. And we all know in the Quran, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرِ. He points his finger at the moon and the moon splits into two. These are clear miracles. And yet the miracle of the Quran is so powerful it eclipses all of these other miracles. It is as if all the other miracles are not even worthy of being mentioned when it comes to the miracle of the Quran. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Surah Al-Ankabut, verse 50. وَيَقُولُونَ they say, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلْ عَلَيْهِ آيَاتٌ مِنْ رَبِّهِ. Why don't more miracles come down? They want to see miracles. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ أَنَّا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ. Isn't it enough of a miracle for them? Isn't it enough of a miracle? أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ. Isn't this sufficient that we have revealed down to them the kitab that is recited in front of them? So the Quran is so powerful of a miracle, Allah is saying, what more do you want? Isn't it enough of a miracle that I have given you this book that is recited to you? And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, through the Quran, challenged them, challenged the Quraysh, challenged all of mankind in 5 different verses in the Quran to produce something similar to the Quran if they're capable of doing it. And each of these 5 verses kept on changing the challenge. At first, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, imitate the whole Quran. They couldn't do that. So then the next comes down, imitate ashri suwar, bring forth 10 surahs. They couldn't do that. So then the next comes down, that bring forth 1 surah. They couldn't do that. Then the next comes down, bring forth anything. فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِثْلِهِ. Bring forth any speech like this. They couldn't do that. So then Allah revealed the 5th verse, and that is the final verse, and that is the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that go and call anybody whom you want to bring forth something like the Quran. If you cannot do it, فَإِلَّمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا, and you can never do it, then be prepared to face the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, even in this gradual change, there is a taunting. Like if somebody says, I'm a strong man. You say, okay, lift 500 pounds. So I can't lift 500. Okay, 300. Okay, 2. You keep on lowering it until finally you get to something that you would think is so reasonable, but he still can't do that. So then his claim is proven to be a lie. So when these people said, what's the big deal about the Quran? Allah said, bring the Quran. They couldn't do that. Then he lowered it. Bring 10 surahs. They couldn't do that. Lowered it again. Bring 1 surah. And so on and so forth. Until finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only said that he lowered it, at the end he actually gave the ultimatum. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا. If you cannot do it, but of a surety you will never be able to do it. So even in this, there is a prediction that nobody can ever imitate the Quran. And this is a historical reality for the last 14 and a half centuries, brothers and sisters. This is a reality that nobody can deny. Nobody has ever brought. There have been attempts, by the way. Don't think that nobody has attempted. There have been attempts by various groups that have opposed Islam, by people who wanted to convert people to their faith. There's books written by many different groups to try to imitate the Quran. But wallahi, even the non-Arabs who will read this, who don't even understand the Quran, when they read this, they find something is wrong here. And most of this, by the way, all that they do is they cut half of one verse and they paste it with half of another verse. So they're actually cutting and pasting from within the Quran to make it sound something similar. They have been attempts, but none of these attempts has ever been successful. And this is the point that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenges. You will never be able to do so. Now, why the Quran? Why is the Quran the biggest challenge? Why is the Quran so big of a challenge that it actually eclipses all of the other challenges? Surely the splitting of the moon is no joke. Surely all of these other miracles are not trivial matters. And yet when you compare them to the miracle of the Quran, they are insignificant. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged them through a miracle that they could best appreciate. What did the Arabs pride themselves on? We said the Romans prided themselves on medicine. We said that the ancient Egyptians, they practiced the dark arts of black magic. What did the Arabs pride themselves on? What was their one forte? What was their one, if you like, positive, that if anybody attempted to challenge them in that one positive, they would be able to beat? And this was, of course, Arabic eloquence. This was what they prided themselves on. Not in building high buildings, what were the Arabs known for? It was the art of balagha. It was the art of eloquence. And they could bring forth different types of poetry and different types of what we would call a spoken rhyme, if you like, which is now nathr, or if you like a type of rap, if you like, this is a modern type of thing. The Arabs had this, where it's not quite poetry, but it's something that sounds very similar. The Arabs had it, it's called nathr. They had nathr, and they had different types of balagha. So they prided themselves. And as you know, they would hold competitions every year before the coming of Islam. In Hajj time, this is how important it was. One of the highlights of Hajj was, as soon as Hajj finished, they would gather together on the plains of Mina and they would have a poetry competition. Every tribe would give, bring forth its best poet, and they will see who will win. There will be a team of neutral judges, and whoever wins, they will get their poems hung on the Kaaba. And to this day, we have the classics, the masterpieces of that era, and the seven greatest of them are studied to this day. They're called Al-Mu'allaqat Al-Sab'ah, the seven hanging poems. Why are they called the hanging poems? Because they were literally hung from the Kaaba. This is before the Prophet began preaching, when he was a young man. Al-Mu'allaqat Al-Sab'ah, some of them, they date to the Prophet's youth. Some of them, they date a few years before he was born. These are the seven most famous poems, and they are still available. Arabs who are studying Arabic literature, and anybody who's studying classical Arabic, they will study the seven mu'allaqat. So we know the style, we know the rhythm, we know the rhyme, we know what was in vogue at the time. And it is a miracle of Allah that this has been preserved, by the way. But it has been preserved. Then what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that book that dumbfounded them, confused them. What type of speech is this? Where is this coming from? And the fact of the matter is that the miracle that our Prophet was given, because he is the final prophet, and we also believe he is the best prophet, he is the most blessed of all prophet, he therefore earned, or Allah blessed him with the biggest miracle given to any prophet. And that's a point that needs to be understood. The miracle of our Prophet ﷺ was far bigger than any miracle given to any other prophet. And this is because of two reasons. Number one, our Prophet ﷺ is the final prophet. There will be no prophet after him. So if there's no prophet after him, there's not going to be any more miracles. So there has to be a miracle that is the biggest of all miracles. It is a miracle that doesn't need any other prophet to talk about a previous prophet. Because you see what happened in previous times. Every prophet's message is corrupted. Every prophet's message goes away. Then what happens? Another prophet has to come. Another prophet is sent. As for our Prophet ﷺ, no prophet's going to come after him. So his miracle must be so powerful, you don't need another prophet after him. And also, our Prophet ﷺ is Khatamun Nabiyin, and he is Sayyidul Mursaleen. He is the Sayyid, the leader of all the messengers. So the leader deserves the best, doesn't he not? And therefore, our Prophet ﷺ is given the best miracle of all. And this is exactly what our Prophet ﷺ said. Hadith is in Sahih Bukhari. He said, there has never been any prophet, ما من نبي إلا وقد أوتي من الآيات. There has been no prophet except that he has been given miracles because of which his people believed in him. As I said, every prophet has been given miracles. Then what did our Prophet say? وَإِنَّمَا The only thing I have been given. إِنَّمَا is exclusive. The only thing I have been given is وَحِي يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ The revelation, the wahi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has inspired me with. Now pause here. Technically, our Prophet has been given many miracles. As we said, you can write 12 volumes like Al-Bayhaqi. And this is a printed book, by the way. That's why I'm mentioning it. Al-Bayhaqi's Dala'il al-Nubuwwah. You can find it in the classical bookstores. I have it in my library. 12 volumes, we have it. All of these are full of miracles. And yet, what is our Prophet that I'm saying? The only miracle I have been given. Why? Because when you have the sun, you don't mention the candles. The sun is shining, you don't care about the light bulbs. Yeah, there's lots of mini miracles. But in reality, comparison to the big miracle, all of these other miracles are extinguished. So he says, وَإِنَّمَا The only miracle I have been given is the wahi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has inspired me with. And therefore, I hope to have the largest ummah on the Day of Judgment. Notice how he linked what with what. Look at this hadith. What did he link? He said, every prophet has miracles. Then he wants to say, what is his miracle? But he says, but I only got one miracle. وَإِنَّمَا I only got one miracle. But then he concludes the hadith. Because of this one miracle, I am optimistic. وَأَرْجُ I'm optimistic that I will have the largest number of followers on Yawm Al-Qiyamah. What does that show you about the miracle? It's the best miracle. It's the most obvious miracle. It's the most powerful miracle. It's the miracle that is the miracle of miracles. Because it is such a big miracle, I am confident that I will have the largest number of followers on Yawm Al-Qiyamah. That's how big the miracle of the Qur'an is. Now, how is the Qur'an so miraculous? Well, much can be said, and inshallah, in a few weeks, I'll give a part two of this khutbah to continue what we're saying. But in this khutbah, I want to emphasize really only two points and then move on to the rest of the khutbah. And we will continue the theme in a later khutbah, inshallah ta'ala. In this khutbah, I want to emphasize two points that really set apart the Quranic miracle from every other miracle. Number one, the Quranic miracle is the only eternal miracle. Al-Mu'jizatul Khalida, as one of our modern Arabic scholars said. He wrote a book about the eloquence of the Quran and the power of the Quran. He called it Al-Mu'jizatul Khalida, the eternal miracle. The Quran is the only eternal miracle. There's no miracle that removes what is called the time-space factor. What is this fancy time-space factor? Time-space literally means one time in one space. Let's go back, rewind in history. Did Musa alayhi salam split the Red Sea? Every Muslim will say, yes, he did. Every Jew and believing Jew and Christian will say, yes, he did. Those who are not Muslim, Jew or Christian, they will say, bring me your proof. What's your proof? You will say, the book says so. He's going to say, I don't believe in the book. Did Jesus Christ resurrect the dead? Every Christian will say yes. Every Muslim will say yes. Everybody else will say, what's your evidence? If you were not there, if you didn't see Lazarus come out of the grave, his name was Lazarus according to the New Testament. If you didn't see Lazarus come out of the grave, how do you know? You have to have faith. You have to have faith based on what? It's blind faith as of yet. You just believe Allah said so, so it's true. So, if you were not there to witness these miracles, the fact of the matter is that these miracles don't support your faith. Rather, your faith supports the miracles. And that's why you cannot prove these miracles to anybody. To this day, everybody who's an agnostic, an atheist, a secularist, even many Christians and Jews that have left their traditional beliefs, they doubt now, well, maybe Moses didn't actually split the Red Sea. Maybe there was just some storm that came and, you know, something strange happened. They don't believe this anymore because they cannot imagine something supernatural, right? So if you hadn't witnessed the miracle, there is no miracle for you. Therefore, all of the previous miracles that ever existed, in reality, they are no longer miracles for those who didn't see them. It's simply you believe that Allah said so, which we believe, alhamdulillah. What is the one miracle that you didn't have to be there to witness it? You can still feel it, touch it, smell it, literally hear it. What is the one miracle that has removed the time-space factor? You don't need to be alive in 7th century Arabia to witness this miracle. You can be in Memphis, Tennessee in 2013. You can be in Alaska or Timbuktu. You can be anywhere in the world in any century. And somebody says, how do you know Islam is true? Here's the Quran. Read it. Ponder over it. Think about it. Listen to it. The miracle is here. It's al-mu'jizatul khalida. It's the only eternal miracle that any prophet has ever been given. And this is one of the most wondrous things about the Quran. It removes the time-space factor. Another interesting thing about the Quran is that the Quran is the only miracle in which no miracle is needed to prove it is the Quran. Let me elaborate. Jesus Christ, Moses, all of the other prophets, somebody challenges Jesus. How do we know you're actually preaching the words of God? How do we know the Injil is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Jesus' followers will say, didn't you see he resurrected the dead? Didn't you see he healed the blind? Didn't you see this and that? Clearly, these ayat prove that Jesus Christ is getting a revelation from Allah. The same goes for Musa. How do we know you're a prophet of God? Well, didn't you see this? Didn't you see that? In each one of these examples, the evidence that proves the claim is separate from the claim itself. It's exhibit A leads you to conclusion B. Exhibit A, Moses splits the Red Sea. Conclusion B, Moses is a prophet of God. Exhibit A, Jesus Christ resurrects the dead. Conclusion, he's a prophet of God. So the evidence is separate from the conclusion. How about the Quran? The Quran is the only book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in which the evidence and the conclusion have been combined together. The Quran does not need external evidence to substantiate its claim. The Quran doesn't need exhibit A, exhibit. It is the evidence and it is the proof. It is the message and it is the proof of the message combined in one. Self-sufficient. You don't need to go external from the Quran. Whereas the previous Prophet's followers, they needed to go external. As for the Quran, the Hujjah is the same as the Bayan and the Wahi. The Wahi is the Hujjah, the Hujjah is the Wahi. The evidence is the inspiration. And the two have been combined together. And no other prophet has been given such a powerful miracle. And if you look at both of these factors, you appreciate how different the Quran is from every other miracle given to the previous prophets. And this is why when the Quran was revealed, it caused a huge impact. It caused a huge impact. And there are so many beautiful stories that we learn from our seerah about what will happen when the people first heard the Quran. And just to give you some examples, the story of Utbah ibn al-Rabi'ah. Utbah ibn al-Rabi'ah was a distant uncle of the Prophet ﷺ. When the Quran, when the wahi began, when the Prophet ﷺ began preaching. So right at the beginning of the da'wah, this is like the second or third year, when he just began preaching his public message. Utbah ibn al-Rabi'ah said, when the Quraysh said, what should we do? Should we ban him? Should we exile him? Utbah said, have any of you spoken to him? Have any of you tried to go to him directly? And because they actually, in some strange way, respected the Prophet ﷺ so much, because he was so beloved to them, they never actually, up until that point, hadn't gone to him directly and confronted him directly. And that shows you his status. You know, when you respect somebody, you're a bit embarrassed to bring something directly to his attention. The Prophet ﷺ was so respected, none of the elders of the Quraysh actually had the audacity, if you like, to actually go to him directly. So Utbah says, have you spoken to him directly? They all shrugged their shoulders. We haven't done that yet. So Utbah, and he was an elder and he was a distant uncle, said, let me go. So Utbah went to the Prophet ﷺ and he tried to reason with him. You're an intelligent man. We had hopes for you. You're going to be our leader. Why are you doing this? Why are you splitting the community? So the Prophet ﷺ said, have you finished what you came to say? He said, yes. So he said, now it's my turn. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حاميم والكتاب المبين. And he started reciting to him verses from Surah Al-Dukhan. He started reciting to him the Quran. Utbah had never heard the Quran before. And the books of Sirah mention Utbah was sitting with his hands behind his back, like the casual way, you know, that they're sitting, his hands behind his back. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he begins reciting and Utbah's face begins to change. He's never heard anything like this. Eventually, the Prophet reaches an ayah, which is on the second page. It says that if you reject, فَقَدْ أَنذَرْتُكُمْ صَاعِقَةَ مِثْلَ صَاعِقَةِ عَادٍ وَثَمُودٍ. If you reject this message, then I warn you, you will be punished like the thunderbolts that punished Aad and Thamud. So if you read the surah, which we don't have time to do, it's building up to a climax, it's building up to a pitch. By the time he got to this verse, Utbah became white with fear. He jumped up and he put his hand on the Prophet's mouth and he said, I beg you as a blood relative of mine, please stop and don't bring this punishment. SubhanAllah, look, this is a pagan, a kafir. He dies a kafir, he never accepts Islam. Listening to the Quran, he literally thinks out of the heavens a thunderbolt's going to come right then and there. And he jumps up, he puts his hand on the mouth of the Prophet. He said, I beg you by my rights over you as a blood relative, that stop, don't do this, don't bring that punishment. Look, where did this come from? And then he rushes back to the parliament of the Quraysh, the Nadi of the Quraysh. And they say, when they saw him coming, his face is completely bloodless, is completely white with fear. They say, this is not the Utbah that left. He left 20 minutes ago, half an hour ago. He was enthused, he was charged, he was going to change the world. Now he's coming whimpering, this is not the same Utbah. And so Utbah comes and he said, I have heard a speech, the likes of which I have never heard before. Leave this man alone, for verily this speech will have naba'un azim. It's going to have an amazing story to it. Something's going to happen, and we don't want to get in the way of it. And so they said, you have been bewitched. You have been basically taken in by his spell as well. But this is Utbah ibn Rabi'ah. So many other stories. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, the father of Khalid. Khalid ibn al-Walid, this is al-Walid. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, he was the Shakespeare of the Quraysh. He was the main poet of the Quraysh. This is al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. That's the number one person. When the competition comes, that's al-Walid. Al-Walid is the chieftain of Banu Makhzum, which Abu Jahl belonged to. This is al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. He's the chieftain. And that's why he's the chieftain, because he's the most eloquent. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira is their Shakespeare. One day he's walking, and the Prophet is reciting Quran in his house. And Al-Walid is transfixed. He stays, he's mesmerized. He's never heard anything like it. The whole Makkah hears that Al-Walid is impressed. Al-Walid is dumbfounded. He's stupefied because he's standing outside the house of the Prophet and listening to the Quran. And he walks away basically unnerved, what is going to be done. So Abu Jahl comes to him, and Abu Jahl was his cousin. Abu Jahl comes to him and says, Oh my uncle, he's elder to him in age. Oh my uncle, the whole community is talking about what happened. That the Quran mesmerized you. The whole community is talking about this. You need to say something against the Quran. You need to do something. So Al-Walid says, وَمَاذَا أَقُولُ What do you want me to say? فَوَاللَّهِ I have heard a speech the likes of which I have never heard before. And he said, and you know, this is a private conversation between Abu Jahl, and you know that I am the most knowledgeable of you in the poetry of men, بَلْ حَتَّى فِي شِعْرِ الْجِنِّ He said, even in the poetry of jinn, I am a master. Perhaps this is a boast that they would say, I'm the poetry of the jinn. And yet I have never heard a speech like this. And indeed, وَإِنَّ عَلَيْهِ لَحَلَاوَ There is a halawa in it. There's a mesmerizing beauty in it. وَإِنَّهُ فِيهِ لَطَلَاوَ It's going to be a conquering over it. وَإِنَّهُ يَعْلُو وَلَا يُعْلَى عَلَيْهِ This is a speech that conquers all other speeches, and no speech can conquer it. This is the testimony of their best poet. Abu Jahl said, Oh my uncle, my people will not be satisfied from you until you speak out. There's a threat here. You had better speak out or else. I'm going to be your enemy. It's a threat here. So he said, let me think. دعني أفكر. Let me think. And the Quran, Surah Al-Mudathir, summarizes this entire private conversation and the mental, psychological state of Walid. That he's walking back and forth. He's frowning. He's thinking. إِنَّهُ فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ ثُمَّ قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ ثُمَّ نَظَرَ ثُمَّ عَبَسَ وَبَصَرَ ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ وَاسْتَكْبَرَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the privacy of his house exposes Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. What he's doing, nobody knows but Allah knows. And in the Quran, to this day we recite what was happening with Al-Walid and how confused he is and how frantic he is. And he's walking back and forth and he's frowning. This is the Quran. Go ahead and challenge this Al-Walid. What can you do? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatens him. And before Al-Walid could release his official statement, Allah released it for him. This is what you're going to say. Because you have nothing else to say. The worst that he could say, in هذا إلا قول البشر. This is the words of a man. He is a skilled poet who has some magic with him. So he mixed some magic and poetry. He's a skilled, magical poet. That's all he could say. He couldn't bring forth anything new. And this is the story of Al-Walid ibn Mughira. So many other stories as well. We don't have time to get to Jubayr ibn Mut'im and Umar ibn Khattab. We put them in a separate category because they both converted because of the Quran. They both converted because of the Quran. That Jubayr ibn Mut'im, his father was the famous Mut'im ibn Adi. I've given a lecture about Mut'im ibn Adi. This is his son, Jubayr ibn Mut'im. That he said, when I was a prisoner in the Battle of Badr, and I was taken to the Masjid of the Prophet in Medina, and I was made to sit there for 2-3 days waiting for the ransom to come, the first time I heard the Quran in Salat al-Maghrib of that day. They came to Medina in the morning after the Battle of Badr, around Dhuhr time they're coming. So the first recitation he hears is Salat al-Maghrib. And he tells us exactly what the Prophet is reciting. SubhanAllah, brother. And sisters, we're mesmerized by Abdul Basit, Abdul Samad, by Manshawi, by Husari, by Afasi, by these modern guys. Can you imagine if we had heard the tilawa of the Prophet, what would that have been like? Can you imagine his voice? So here is Jubayr ibn Mut'im. He has just been taken a prisoner of war, POW. His hands are tied up. He is in the side of the masjid. And he says, the first time I heard the Quran, Salat al-Maghrib, the Prophet recited Surah al-Tur in its entirety. Surah al-Tur in its entirety. And Surah al-Tur is a powerful tour. And Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْنَ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ أَمْ خَلَقُوا السَّمَاوَاتِ رَضَ بَلْ لَا يُوقِنُونَ It's a powerful, it's rhetorical questions. Where do they come from? Who created them? Did they create themselves? Did they create the heavens and earth? And so Jubayr ibn Mut'im said, كَادَ كَلْبِ قَلْبِ أَنْ يُطِيرُ My heart was about to break out of my chest and fly out. The palpitation, the nervousness, the emotional, listening to the Quran, كَادَ قَلْبِ أَنْ يُطِيرُ That my heart was about to fly away. Listening to the tilawa of the Prophet ﷺ, and that was the first time iman entered my heart. And the story of Umar is all known to you. How did he convert? Once again, the animosity was not based on hearing the Quran. When he actually heard the Quran and read the Quran, what happened? It melted his heart. So the reality, brothers and sisters, if this is the impact of the Quran upon those who rejected it, then the question arises, what should be the impact on us who believe in the Quran? What should be the impact on us who already know it is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What does Allah say in the Quran? That if we had revealed this book to a mountain, the mountain would have trembled and crumbled having heard the Quran. One of the scholars of the Tabi'un said, if this is the case with the hard mountain, what should be the case of the soft heart of the Muslim? How should that heart react, brothers and sisters? This is the miracle of the Quran. Barakallahu wa lakum fil Quran al-Azim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bima fihi min ayati wa dhikri al-hakim aqulu ma tasma'un wa astaghfirullaha al-'azima li wa lakum wa li sa'iri muslimin kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Al-Wahid, Al-Ahad, Al-Samad, Al-Ladhi, Lam Yalid, Walam Yulad, Walam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad, Wa Ba'du. Can I ask the brothers to please move forward so that brothers outside can come in. Brothers and sisters, why am I talking about the Quran a few days after Ramadan? Because the one thing that all of us did in this month of Ramadan was to increase our Quran. And why would we not? Because the month of Ramadan is linked with the Quran. Ramadan is Ramadan because of the Quran. Ramadan is Ramadan because of the Quran. What does Allah say in the Quran? شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. The month of Ramadan is when the Quran came down. إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. We have revealed it on the night of Qadr. The Quran, Laylatul Qadr. The Quran, Ramadan. The reason why Ramadan is because of the Quran. And therefore, throughout the globe, every Muslim who even has an atom's weight of Iman will increase not just their sawm, something to do with the Quran, a little bit extra reading, a little bit extra hearing, there will be a new relationship with the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So brothers and sisters, during this month, we have listened to the Quran, many of us in its entirety. During this month, we have read the Quran, many of us in its entirety, and some amongst us double, triple, three, four, five times. Alhamdulillah. All of us who have Iman, insha'Allah ta'ala, our Iman has been reinvigorated. Our Iman has increased because and through the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now that Ramadan is over, brothers and sisters, the question is, what will our relationship be with that same book? Ramadan reintroduced us to our love, and that is the Quran. It caused us to think once again about the sweetness of the Quran. And wallahi, brothers and sisters, every one of us here understands this because we have enjoyed this. Whether we understand the Arabic or not, we understand the beauty of the Quran. Even those who don't understand a word of what it means, listening to the tilawa brings sakina to the heart. Listening to the tilawa increases iman. Listening to the tilawa removes anxieties. We know this. Wallahi, we all know this. Arab and non-Arab. Whether we understand the Quran or not. And I speak, alhamdulillah, as both. Once upon a time, I didn't understand a word of Arabic. I had memorized the Quran and I didn't speak a word of Arabic. And I know the impact the Quran had on me then. Then Allah blessed me to study Arabic and understand. And then the impact is, of course, much more than that. But even as a person, as a teenager, who didn't understand a word of Arabic, as a young man, I can attest myself. Yes, indeed, the Quran moves you to tears, even though you don't speak a word of Arabic. And what a mu'jiza that is. What a miracle that is. That many of us, we don't fully appreciate. We don't fully thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. Now that the month is over, brothers and sisters, what will our relationship be with that book? Are we going to put it back to that top shelf, never to be taken down until the very next Ramadan? Is that what this book is about? To be just put there for decoration? Or to be put there only when somebody passes away that you dust it off? Or to be put there only for the month of Ramadan? Brothers and sisters, nothing increases iman like the Quran does. Nothing increases iman like the Quran does. The Quran itself mentions the increasing of iman by reading the Quran, by reciting the Quran. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is commanded to recite the Quran in the singular. Utlu ma uhiya ilayka min al-kitab. Watlu ma uhiya. In the singular, Allah tells him, one person, Ya Rasulullah, you must do tilawa of the Quran. Go ahead and recite the Quran. And the believers are commanded to recite the Quran. They're characterized as those who recite the Quran frequently. الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابَ يَتْلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ. Who are the believers in the Quran? The Quran says, يَتْلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ. They recite it the way it deserves to be recited, both quantity and quality. They recite the Quran, حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ, the way it deserves to be recited. This is a characteristic of Iman. And the Quran has over 6 verses that link increasing of Iman with the recitation of the Quran. Iman goes up when the Quran is recited. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when a surah is revealed, the munafiqun say, whose iman has gone up? فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. As for the believers, their iman goes up because of this new surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. When they hear the Quran, their iman goes up. This is just by hearing. What do you think of reciting yourself? Just by hearing the Quran, your iman should go up. How about those who recited? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Christians and Jews who have goodness in their hearts. Allah says that those of them, the Ahli Kitab, who have goodness in their heart, وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ, when they hear what this has been revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, you find they began crying because of the wahi that has been revealed. They are crying, they're Christians and Jews. They're crying out of love, joy, fear, hope, all of these emotions. If this is the case of Christians and Jews who have some good in their heart, how about the Muslim who knows the Quran to be the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Brothers and sisters, the khutbah, the message I'm going to leave you with in this khutbah, the theme of this khutbah is very simple, brothers and sisters. Now that the month is over, I remind myself and all of you that each and every one of us needs to have that relationship with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask myself first and foremost, and then all of you, for two simple things. Two simple tasks. Two simple items to do. Number one, every one of us needs to incorporate daily Quran into our schedule. Not weekly, not monthly, not yearly. Daily Quran. Brothers and sisters, there is nothing that increases Iman like the Quran. And every one of us, we are already suffering from Ramadan withdrawal symptoms. Our Iman is going down a bit. Every one of us is missing the brotherhood, the spirituality. It's human nature. How do we revive that? How do we make sure it's going to be on a high? The number one way is the Quran. The number one, there is no number two that competes with this. Number one, and that's by itself, because the Quran mentions it in its own category. And that is tilawa of the Quran. Every one of us should incorporate the Quran daily. And even if it's only 10 minutes a day, even though if we do more it's better, but even if it's 10 minutes, and my advice to myself and all of you, do it the first thing that you wake up, before you take your breakfast, before you do anything else. If you come and pray Fajr, or you just after Fajr, you sit down for 10-15 minutes. Do some basic tilawa. And keep on recurring the whole Quran. Start from the beginning. Work your way to the end. Work your way back. Make this a continual thing. And I ask you to do this for 1 week. Just 1 week. And then you tell me yourself how much your soul has been nourished by that Quran. And then you tell me yourself, the day that you don't follow that practice, how do you feel that day? Wallahi, brothers and sisters, reading the Quran is the nourishment of the soul. And if the day goes by that you don't nourish your soul, you will feel it worse than when the day goes by and you don't have breakfast and lunch. You will feel it worse than that. You will feel something is wrong. The Quran cleanses the heart. The Quran softens the heart. The Quran increases the iman of the heart. So number one call of action, incorporate the Quran into your daily routine. 10 minutes, wallahi, is not that much. And I tell you 10 is very little, but even 10, khalas, better than zero. 10 minutes a day, start off. Then wallahi, after 1 month, after 3 months, wallahi, brothers and sisters, you yourself will say, 10 is not enough. I want some more breakfast. I want some more time with the Quran. You will notice yourself, your change in life, your positive attitude, your energy, your enthusiasm, your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You yourself will notice this. And then it will become a part of your daily routine. And the second thing I advise myself and all of you is that no matter what your level is of the Quran, increase the quality of recitation. The first was quantity. The second now is quality. Many of us, and let me be very frank here, brothers and sisters, please don't take this the wrong way. Regardless of whether we are of Arab ethnicity or not, the fact of the matter is most of us have not learned how to recite the Quran properly. We don't know the basic rules. When do you stop? When do you do ghunna? When do you do mudud? We don't know this stuff. And I swear by Allah, and take this from a non-Arab, you don't have to be an Arab to master the rules of tajweed. I mastered them as a non-Arab. I mastered them as somebody who didn't know any Arabic at the time. You don't need, I was teaching tajweed, alhamdulillah, before Allah Ta'ala, before I learned how to speak Arabic. So for, and I say this, astaghfirullah, not to boast, astaghfirullah, but so that those of you who don't speak Arabic, the excuse is, oh, that's an Arab science, I'm not an Arab. Subhanallah, ya brothers and sisters who are not Arabs. Firstly, just because you're an Arab doesn't mean you know how to recite the Quran. Frankly, most Muslims, Arab and non-Arab, don't know how to recite the Quran properly. With all respect, I'm not trying to be, but this is just a fact. Most Muslims do not know how to recite the Quran. Secondly, the science of tajweed has nothing to do with knowing the meaning. It's a simple science. Where is their ghunna? Where is their mud? Where is the letter? You don't need to know the meaning. It's just the letters. You recognize the letters. And alhamdulillah, you know that MIC is opening up a program for tajweed. Within 3 weeks, inshallah, we're going to have a full-time person over here for tajweed. What more do you want? The opportunity is here. He's going to be catering to every single situation, every single intermediate, basic, advanced, those who don't know the Arabic alphabet even, that inshallah will have a class for them. So what excuse is there? And if that is too awkward, find somebody else closer to your house. But the opportunities are there, brothers and sisters. Quantity and quality must be increased, brothers and sisters. And when you do so, inshallah, you will see the fruits of this in this dunya before the next. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the Quran, the Quran, the Quran. The Quran is the ultimate miracle of the Prophet. It is the ultimate way of increasing our iman. It is the rope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down. It is that which is sirat al-mustaqim. It is the miracle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is the nourishment of our ruh. Brothers and sisters, the Quran, the Quran, the Quran. Keep this a part of your routine. Make it a part of your life and your lifestyles. And inshaAllah ta'ala, the barakah will be seen in this world before the next. Allahumma inni da'in fa'aminu. Allahumma la tada'na fi hadha yawmi ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا عسيرا إلا يسرته اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم من أرادنا أو أراد الإسلام والمسلمين بسوء فاشغله بنفسه واجعل تدميره في تدبيره يا قوي يا عزيز عباد الله إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ به بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه وثلث بكم أيها المؤمنون من جنه وإنسه فقال عز من قائل عليما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين عباد الله إن الله تعالى يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه يزد لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر وأقم الصلاة